killer queen, gunpowder guilty, dynamite with a laser beam, guaranteed to blow your mind.
That they would be there for us and not require us to be anything that they'd seen before. They were very open-minded Queen audiences, so we never felt constrained.
Can I see what you might do slowly?
Well, that position, right? Getting up and coming forward. We'll all sort of split up there. So, I mean,
you come back. You want to hit a.
The move you make forward is fairly slow.
At the end,
isn't
it really? Too
fast. The move they make forward is fairly slow.
It is fairly slow, isn't it?
Because it kind of goes. Yeah. I come forward, and all these have to be taken.
Is that true?
Oh, I'm a cold, heartless bugger. No, it has absolutely nothing. It's just pure commercial. Call it what you like.
Can you go easy on the stage lights, because they're so fucking hot. Oh, that's a bit better for now.
It'd work if you could dodge down a bit lower even still. Then you can't see the... There's no way you'll see the notes. There's no way you'll see them.
I can't.
It doesn't work, huh? Yeah.
The only way is to bring the sheet over.
Have you got a black card? Any capture card?
Or
just a bit of black drape that we can put in front.
Black drape?
Yeah.
The only place where everybody has a feeling of like being in a team, but you're not fighting anybody.
Basically, it is a participation thing. I've been very cold-blooded enough.
We're going to be finishing off filming for We Are the Champions, which, of course, you know, is the new single from the band, yeah? I don't know whether you've heard it, first of all. Have you heard it on the radio? Yeah. I understand it's number two on the hit line on Capital Radio tonight, so if I were you. We'd like your involvement, if you would, towards the end, because if you've got any banners that you can wave towards the end, hundreds, I know it. Get those out and shout and scream and sing with the band.
Thank you.
champions, the current anchor position in the chart.
Congratulations, you're number one on the hit line at the moment. How's that for loyalty?
I think it's great. I quite enjoy all this battle, you know, between ABBA and whoever, you know, X, no, whatever, you know. It's very enjoyable, you know. It's always when I sort of, I must admit, I did quite often tune in. And it's nice to hear if it's not wrong. It's a very good instant reaction to what you've sort of put out.
And only Queen could come up with the title We Are the Champions. I mean, where's the modesty gone?
Well, there isn't any. There's no modesty whatsoever. After the slagging's off what we get from the English music press, I mean, who cares? I mean, we've got nothing to lose now.
I think Queen fans will be surprised because it's far more kind of raw than any other album, and also shorter tracks.
I'm glad you said raw, because that was exactly really what we wanted.
Have you enjoyed it tonight, Rudd?
Oh, yeah, fine. It was all right, you know.
Freddie ranges from the creative atmosphere of the recording studio to his beautifully furnished home, to the world's most exclusive antique houses and restaurants.
I used to follow sort of Smile a lot, you know, and we were like friends. I used to go to their shows and they used to come see mine.
What did you see in what Brian and Rudd were doing with Smile?
Nothing. I don't know, I think they had the basic ingredients of what we wanted to do, which was a sort of couple, just very briefly, a couple sort of hard rock with an overlay of harmonies, you know. So we decided we'd, you know, take the plunge. And it was then I sort of thought about the name Queen. You know, I had it in the back of my mind. I thought one day, you know, that could be, we could put that to good use.
Why Queen?
I don't know. At the time, it was outrageous.
At that time, it sort of, the name sort of lent itself to a lot of things, a lot of the theatre and
the kind of things that we wanted to do.
Very grand, you know, very pompous, all those kind of connotations. It meant so much, you know. It was nice. You couldn't sort of just, it wasn't just one precise label. It could have meant a lot of things.
Hard rock in those days was always found this sort of in the blues way, where it was kind of 12 bars and lots of heavy crashing chords. And then there was the other side where it was a lot of melodic sort of ballad type things. And I just thought, why can't the two come together? I mean, why can't you have a good melodic song with a lot of heavy content? And we just thought that would be interesting. Mm. So, I mean, subsequently songs like Liar. I mean, you know, there was a long sort of gap between actually forming Queen and actually having a recording contract. Mm. We'd formed Queen before, I mean, I can say this, you know, now, before sort of David Bowie had done anything. Basically, it is a participation thing. I've been very cold-blooded, and I'm just thinking in terms of how we're going to sort of adapt it on stage, and then how people are going to. It's a public stroke group thing, really.
Let's talk about writing for a second, Freddie. Mm. How prolific a writer are you?
Oh, I write a dozen a day.
does it come easy?
It can, if I put my mind to it, yes. I mean, I'm not sort of blowing my own trumpet, but I do churn them out quite quickly, far quicker than the others, I think. They know that. But
what are the ideal sort of set of circumstances for you when you're writing?
I have to be alone. I just have to be left alone, locked up, and I just sort of concentrate. Usually, the way I write is I get the sort of melody first, because that's the most important. It comes easier to me anyway. Mm. I work out the melody, I work out the song structure, and then somehow the words fit in afterwards. Mm. Lyrically, I'm very bad, actually. I really have to work. I hate lyrics. I wish I had a Bernie Taupin, you know, where somebody just gave me the lyrics. Or people were going to take to it. Most of the time, I have a clear picture of what I want, and I sort of have a lot of, say, Roger's parts and what Brian should do and things. There are rows, of course. He's got the dog whistle pitch, you know, very high voice. To try and keep their attention, you've got to sort of really tempt them. Like, okay, even have a little break, have a coffee and biscuits. And then while they're sort of in a good mood, grab them, you know, and do another sort of 50 million overdubs. We had a clear picture of what we wanted to do. there were certain fixed ideas we had, and we were going to bloody do them, you know, whether people said yes or no. The moment we came out with the first album, they put us in an immediate heavy category. And to a lot of other bands, I mean, that would have meant, oh, great, you know, let's do what the media expects us to do. But we didn't. I mean, we knew we wanted to do a particular thing, like sort of branch out into sort of actual songwriting. We don't look upon singles as sort of, I don't know, as the same other people look upon singles, you know, like, I don't know, commerciality. I suppose that's one of the ingredients. But I think it's just our way of saying this is what we're doing at the time. And we felt that Bohemian Rhapsody summed it up at that time, and we were doing a lot of diverse things, a lot of complex harmonies. Mm. You know, it was full of extremes, and we thought, why not? It's one of the songs I had a lot of fun in, because I thought, I'm going to do exactly as I please, do as many multi-layer harmonies as possible, you know, go well over the top. And, you know, didn't give a shit about anybody else. It was a very big risk. I mean, I remember Roger saying this. It's one of those things that we said, OK, it's either going to be a huge flop. As it was a song of extremes, you know, I thought that was the way we were going to approach it.
How does the studio situation work, Freddie?
You mean amongst us?
Yes.
Between us?
Yeah.
If I write a song, then I sort of take it upon myself from the actual writing stages to the rehearsing, to the routining and to the recording as being my project, so I sort of handle that. Mm. With my kind of songs, I seem to sort of more or less have everything rehearsed. I mean, everything's sort of written out.
Because pulling We Are the Champions off the new album, that seems to me to have thoughts and sentiments in it that you must have been wanting to express for some time. Mm. Is that true?
Oh, I'm a cold, heartless bugger. No, it has absolutely nothing. It's just pure commercial. Call it what you like.
Bob and Freddie, take 7. Do you enjoy record production, Fred? Do you enjoy working with CD?
Yes. You can get sick of it, though. Especially now, we've decided that on our albums, we wouldn't spend as much time as we've done in the past, because I just think that, especially with the news of the world, I think we actually did decide before we went in that it was going to be a short album as far as Queen stands concerned. I mean, so that was like 2 months instead of 4. We had something like a week and a half to 2 weeks to actually write all the material in. Mm. And that was nice, so that we didn't fall into this thing of it being overripe before we actually recorded it. I just feel that there are sort of balletic moments in our sort of repertoire. I would like to sort of go and take ballet lessons. It's nice if I could just study just some of the sort of routines so that I know, or exercise, so that I would know how to sort of put them across on stage. At the moment, what I do is mock ballet. From that, I mean, I can live in the kind of lifestyle that I'm used to. I mean, I'm very sort of... you know, people think I'm very grand and whatever. I love it. I am. I mean, I live in a very sort of... I love to sort of... I'm very extravagant. And I don't know, one way or other, even when I didn't have any money, I sort of seemed to do it. It's sort of... I don't know, something that is part of me. I just love enjoying life. A lot of our songs require sophistication and grace and this and that, and I think... there is a certain parallel to ballet.
Yeah. Again, are you conscious of writing at all, with the idea of what...
No, writing is a total different thing. I mean, yeah. I guess I wear my ballet shoes every time I write.
And Freddie's sense of humor prevailed when he agreed to dance with the Royal Ballet. It may well have started in fun, but his performance startled critics and won him great acclaim.
Let's talk about the very early days.
All right.
Shall we, Raj? So what did you do? Put your kit on your back and come up to London?
Well, no, not really, actually. I sort of, I came up and did dentistry in London, and I thought, I didn't know what would happen. I had a kit down in Truro, down in Cornwall, and I suddenly realised that I couldn't stand not being in a group. Mm. So that's when I met Brian. I met him through my flatmate at Imperial College, which is a different college of mine. I met him in the bar one night because he wrote me a letter after I replied, "Ad, we need Ginger Baker, Mitch Mitchell type drummer." And Brian Matt wrote me this long, involved letter, and he sounded quite intelligent, you know, because he liked Jeff Beck and Jimi Hendrix. So I met him, and we got on very well. And that was the sort of beginning. The singer of that band was a guy called Tim Staffel.
So the lineup at this point then was drums, bass, guitar.
And guitar, but everybody sang.
Right.
And Tim was the lead singer, had a tremendously powerful voice. He's done a few things. Smile sort of ground to a halt, really. Because we didn't have a good manager, we didn't really have anything, you know, we were lost in the wilderness. And we were also all students at the time. It ground to a halt. Tim lost interest, it didn't look like it was going anywhere. Freddie was always so keen, and he literally sort of taught himself to play, to understand chords on a guitar, etc., etc. And then he joined a couple of bands while we were in Smile.
Had Freddie had any experience at all?
None at all before Smile was formed. Absolutely none. Apart from Cliff Richard impersonations in front of his mirror. And Freddie sort of got us. He said, come on, you can't give up. I want to sing for you. And nobody really took him that seriously, but he really sort of fused it together. And then which made a core of the three of us.
So at that point, was Freddie already established with Brian as the major writer for the band?
Yes, I suppose so, because they were the ones that did most of the writing. Freddie, by this time, was sort of remembering all his piano lessons. I remember lifting a dreadful old piano up to his top floor flat. And he killed ourselves in the process. And Freddie sort of hammered out the songs which he wrote in the first album. There was one particular gig at Imperial College, and we were just building up a little bit of buzz because some of the gigs had been getting good. And this gig really went well. That was a very good turning point. So we cut some demos in Delane Lee. I had gone for a few interviews. No, audition. They're always rather depressing affairs, you know. You sort of get 80 drum kits in a line.
So how long before the album came out was it recorded and finished?
Hard to remember. I'd say about a good year.
Hmm.
Good year.
And that year was spent doing what?
Giving free concerts for our friends. Playing the odd gig that we could scratch. It took so long, from the time of actually making those tapes. It's just quite unbelievable. I mean, the material was so old as far as we were concerned by then.
Mm.
The album came out and sort of resoundingly crashed. Well, it really didn't do much. When you're recording the album, you tend to think, when you sort of first mix it, etc., you tend to think it's the eighth wonder of the world, which it invariably isn't. But it might be quite good. I mean, I'm sure every artist thinks that. We were always perhaps overconfident, but even arrogant, you know. We were fairly arrogant, yeah. But I don't quite know why.
So Queen 2, then, was the next major stepping stone, wasn't it?
Yes. By this time, we had actually managed to attract some attention.
How long did that album take, then, altogether?
Well, it took about 3.5 months, which in those days was an epic. That album was the first sort of aesthetic nervous breakdown producer that we'd had, because we worked all hours for months. It was the first sort of mammoth job we did. You know, we went about triple the budget that we were originally allowed. But because I think the record company and the production company were pretty sympathetic artistically at that time, and they kept hearing bits and saying, it's great, you know, okay, go on. Anyway, once you're halfway through, they can't really get you to stop. You know? They want an album. We realised that really the easiest way of getting a hit album is to have a hit single that has some musical validity. That's what we thought, and that's what we were set about doing. And it happened very smoothly there. That's when we sort of first really got into production and went completely over the top. You know? There's a track on there called March of the Black Queen. I mean, the tape was literally transparent. The 16-track, 2-inch tape. There was the oxide was almost completely worn away. We'd gone over it so many times, so many overdubs and bounce downs. It literally was transparent. When Queen 2 came out, it had Seven Seas of Rye on it. Almost within 2 weeks, I think, the single was a hit. And the album went straight in as it was released, which was great for us, because we were in the middle of our own first headlining tour. Then we almost immediately went on tour with Mott the Hoople.
Yes.
Which was, for us, which was very successful, brought us to so many new people. And a lot of them have stuck with us ever since. It's quite amazing, as a, from being a support act on a major tour, just a support act, people have actually stuck with us right through, you know. We had some bad luck on that tour because Brian got hepatitis then, and we had to cut the tour in half, come home halfway through because Brian was very ill.
So after the anxiety attack came sheer heart attack, yeah?
Yeah, that was made in even more trying conditions, really, because Brian had just recovered, supposedly recovered from his hepatitis when we made that album. We started off in Wales, and Brian started collapsing all over the place. We found out eventually he had an ulcer, and he'd had it for 6 years, and it was just getting really bad. So Brian had to go into hospital, and the three of us sort of carried on and did a tremendous amount of work on the album, leaving all Brian's bits out. And when he was well again, he came back and sort of did them and slotted them in. And strange enough, I think it's my favourite album.
My particular favourite, obviously, is Now I'm Here. Which also was written about America, presumably,
it
and
was
the tour with
Mott. And Mott. Yeah. And it was a sort of bit of a nod to Mott. Yeah, it's a very enjoyable track. It's done very quickly at the end of the album, actually. Most of the album, actually, it was a hit. Not as big. We never seem to have as big a hits. It's very hard to get a rock and roll hit single anywhere, America or here or Japan. You know, people will always go for the more melodic thing. That is one aspect of Queen that people seem to like. They love the big chorale, the big harmony thing, which we are sort of capable of doing, linked with a strong melody and perhaps a little touch of bizarreness, although not too much. We were doing lots of major tours in Japan, America. We were headlining by now and doing very well and selling loads and loads of records and not seeing any money. We didn't expect instant riches or anything. We didn't get them either. Night at the Opera changed the sort of financial outlook of things. After that, it wasn't so much where's the next Fiverr coming from, you know. It was very, very successful. It had a very successful single, obviously.
You get involved in quite a lot of music outside of the band and outside of the band's style, don't you? I mean, I remember you talking really in the very early days, for example, about Sex Pistols.
If you hear something that's, or hear of something that's exciting, yeah, there seems to be so few.
We had something like a week and a half to 2 weeks to actually write all the material in. And that was nice, so that we didn't fall into this thing of it being overripe before we actually recorded it.
I'll have to sing it. Go on, Anna, go.
One take eight.
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence.
I'm just going to get a rough balance, so I think.
That was a lovely feel. That's exactly how it should be.
A cup of coffee coming. Anybody else want anything?
Yes, please, I'll have a cup.
I'll have a cup with one sugar, please.
Right, that's three coffees with one sugar, one of them.
One and 3/7 sugars, please.
Three sugars?
No, one and 3/7.
Seven sugars?
One and 3/7.
Is this on?
Test, test.
Knock, knock. Hello?
If I write a song, then I sort of take it upon myself from the actual writing stages to the rehearsing, to the routining and to the recording as being my project, so I sort of handle that. With my kind of songs, I seem to sort of more or less have everything rehearsed. I mean,
I've taken my bows and my curtain calls. You brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with it. I want on a pan pot.
What, the echo? Yeah, it will be.
He had a vision, and he was very driven, and he was very good on the desk, you know, and very good moving the faders, balancing the harmonies and getting the things to do what he wanted. But then we'd pitch in with each other's songs, and then sometimes we'd all get together to mix it.
Can you remember which vocals, which solos were used?
What? Well, if you hear them, I'll know.
Because here we've got four tracks of vocals, one with a solo guitar, and then that's got N bit solo.
Well, listen to them, darling, that's the only way we can do it. But if I were you, before you find out, just get a sound on it. Just get like an overall sound on the drum.
That's your writing, isn't it, that one?
No, it's all
mics.
What are you doing
now? I'm just going to get a rough balance, okay? There's two guitars, one crosses over.
Right,
do you remember?
Yes, I remember.
And that one is... Go back to the other place and then you find out.
Just the last chorus? No.
Do you want to do a guitar?
Or something? You know,
I suppose
it would sound different.
Do you want to do a guitar bit in there? Squeeze it in. work out your guitars, then you can mix.
Where are they?
Roger, do you want to come in here and just do
the kit?
Yeah.
What do you think for sounds? I mean, I think we should just...
Yeah, it sounds all right to me.
He has only done drum sounds at the moment.
Sounds right,
isn't it? Oh, well, that's right. Sounds all right to me, isn't it?
What was a roadie?
Oh, let's open a bottle of wine.
Yes, well, where is the screwdriver?
Another party's over, and I'm left cold sober. My baby left me for somebody new. I don't want to talk about it, want to forget about it, want to be intoxicated with that special.
I did electronics. They had quite a few bass players, I hear. I never actually met any of them. I've heard some stories about... I've heard some stories about some of them. And I happened to have got my equipment down in London, so I got myself introduced to them and said I'd be interested. And so basically I went along for an audition. I learned some of the songs, you know. They were doing a lot of some of the numbers. I remember things like Drinking Rat, and one or two other numbers off the first album. The group were, in a way, very much well-formed, you know. I mean, they had all the material for the first album, all bar one or two tracks they were already doing, you know. I mean, they had quite a backlog of songs and the ideas for stage production and, you know, how to put the group over were all there, in a way. I came along in a way as a bit of an outsider at first, and it did take me quite a few years to sort of grow more into the group, you know, and find myself, at home, really. Mm. It was only a spare time thing, you know, even with Queen, you know, I really didn't expect it to take off, really, you know. Mm. The person who's written the song tends to be the one person who sees that one song all the way through from the idea they have in their head at first, you know, the final production, you know, the sounds on everything and the mix.
It's very difficult for any group, the first album you do, always, the studio's a new thing, right? I mean, even on the first album, we managed to get in a bit, you know, I mean.
I heard from a friend that they were looking for the bass guitarist to join, their group. On the first album, we learnt a lot of the ins and outs of the studio. We started working with Roy Baker, really, who's a very technical whiz. He could actually enable us to do all the ideas that we had, you know, and could keep it under control, all the technical things that we wanted to do in the studio. He was able to put those into effect for us. It was the first time we really got into the big halls, you know, the Madison Square Gardens, you know, the Forum in Los Angeles and the Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto, those sort of big things. There we were, we'd had three albums and, you know, we were still there on a basic wage, you know.
So how do each of you then musically pull the band in certain directions? I mean, I'm thinking of your songs, for example, which always strike me as being so melodic,
yes.
John, and add that input into them.
Yes, yeah. Well, that just obviously is comes from the type of songs that the individuals write, you know, because we are four individuals, really, you know. I mean, we are quite different in our musical tastes as well, you know. Mine tends to be, you know, in that slightly lighter, you know. I don't think I could ever write a heavy song, you know. It's not in me.
When did you begin to get to a stage where you felt between you that you could take over the desk yourselves completely?
It comes to a stage where all you really need is an engineer, really, because the idea of balancing and sounds you want. I mean, an artist or musician should really know what they want, you know, and the only person needed to implement that is an engineer, really, in a way. And when you're doing a mix, you know, when you're mixing down the track from the tapes, I mean, you know, it's setting it up, and then we actually sit down and work the controls as well, you know. Yeah. Fred here, isn't
it? Hello.
Uh-oh. Typical.
Righto.
You try to be last, but never make it. Yeah. It's always a battle trying to be last here.
Are you going to make sure that the whole, all the lights, all these gaps are filled?
Oh, yeah.
You must aim for maximum effect, both orally and visually. We're just trying to put over the music and the visual aspect as effectively as we can to as many people as we can.
Strangely enough, the things that people notice most are the beginning and the end.
They've come to see it. They're not going to see it. They want to see what we're going to do. This is a new show. This is something. What we're going to perform.
I think it worked great as an encore, you know.
I think we should do it, but you know, the whole thing of We Will Rock You is stating that. This is a new.
Yeah.
There's no point saying we will rock you after we've rocked them all night long. At the end of the show.
Yeah.
we would talk to each other, look at each other, discuss things.
Hey boy, where did you get it from? Hey boy, where did you go? I learned my passion in the good old fashioned love of boys.
I think Fred and I were the two more extreme characters, probably. It was just hygiene. There's sex and drugs. No, it depends on the era, actually, it depends on the moment. There really wasn't much sex and, well, there wasn't much drugs.
Just hold on tight, that's because I'm a good old lover
boy.
Well, it would be fun to go back to the way we used to play when we first started, which would be quite simple, guitar, bass and drums and vocals and whatever.
Exactly what is on the record, Fred.
You do slow down.
Oh, fuck, slow down.
Slow down.
That's hardly the point.
Please, we'll give it a bit more to
you. We might try and really join in with you. Well, you're expecting all of us to be perfect before you even say, attempt to do anything.
Oh, don't be so fucking ridiculous. How are you going to do it?
How are the rehearsals going, Brian?
Very well up to now, up to their usual standard, I think, which is usually slow up to the last minute and then panic. But it's going okay.
How much time have you put aside this time?
We have a full week here in Shepparton, where we are now, which is without the PA, but we have the monitors, so our stage environment is more or less as it will be. And we have a mock-up of how the lights will be. And then the stuff is dismantled and goes to the States, and we follow it out a week later, and then we have 3 or 4 days with everything, and with John working the PA and everything.
Mm. How much of News of the World are you going to do this time?
News of the World will feature heavily, partly because it's easy to do. Most of the stuff is fairly simple in terms of instrumentation. and it was built around stuff which is easy to do on stage, which really is the first time we've done that since the first album. So there'll be a lot of it. We've already been through five or six numbers off the new album.
It must be interesting finding that exact balance between new material and old material too, Brian.
Definitely, yes. Because a lot of people come to see a show for the familiar things. And always at the end of any artist's show, generally, when he starts doing the old stuff, people respond in a completely different way. So you have to, as you say, you have to strike the balance between doing the things which people want to hear and doing the things which you think you ought to be introducing them to. Strangely enough, the things that people notice most are the beginning and the end.
Well, it was going to be astronomy. It was going to be physics. I had a group called... I dread to tell you. No, I won't tell you what it was called.
Oh, go on.
It was called, I think it was called the Mind Boggles. We needed a drummer, so we advertised in my college notice board. We split up 2 or 3 years later, completely disillusioned, because although we'd had a lot of successful gigs and we played colleges and we played pubs and small clubs up and down the country, we just never got anywhere. And that was really the chastening experience which led to the way we decided to organise Queen. I think that was perhaps the biggest influence of all, the failure of that early venture. We were still a group of people without any contacts in the music business, without any way in, it seemed. I used to go and see people at the Marquee, see groups at the Marquee, and think, now how do you get to that situation? And the answer was that people want to book you if they've heard of you, if you've made a record or something like that. How do you get to make records? Well, you get to make records because if you've played at places like the Marquee where people notice you. And it was definitely, so how do you get in? Head up against brick wall department. First of all, we decided we were going to be ready when the opportunity came. So the first job was to rehearse and write to the point where we thought that we had an act worth presenting to the public. The second thing we thought was to make a good demonstration tape. So we took these four tracks around to everyone in sight, every record company in England. At that point, most of them were interested, but weren't prepared to commit themselves that much, obviously, because they want to see what the band's like on stage and everything else. And we weren't in a position to be very good on stage. We didn't have the equipment and everything. What we decided to do was go with a production company rather than with a record company. And the deal was that we made the album for the production company, which is something like a middleman. It's between the artist and the record company. We make the album for the production company, they sell it to a record company afterwards. And in retrospect, it's probably the worst thing we ever did.
Yeah. it should be a really vent every time we play.
People are paying money to come and see you. So
yes,
I
mean, as far as we're concerned, we're putting on a show. It's not just another rendition of an album. If that was the case, we might as well just have sort of cardboard cutouts and just play the album.
Halfway through the tour with Queen now, and it's proving to be, relative to everything else that's on the road this autumn, a very, very successful tour. We've just come back from a gig at the Atlanta Stadium, and we're just going up, I've already got one, to the bar to get another drink.
West could get on your nerves because of the sheer repetition of it, and every town looks so much like the other. And you did feel like you were in a culture vacuum sometimes.
Sorry.
All we have is bad televisions, vibrating beds, even worse, and bad food. But it was still a lot of fun. There was loads of sex and drugs and no. There wasn't much drugs.
Drawing from a completely unique collection of sources, he's assembled a lifestyle that resembles few others, at least in the latter half of this century.
I lost my shoe.
Cinderella. I'm
waiting for the other one.
Trousers, you'll still see my legs.
He's just gonna get my shoe. Why don't you do a nice picture of Roger's pigs?
Taylor dies
while
again.
Yeah. Away!
Good shot, John. John in his skivvies.
His legs. Hey, please.
Yes, these are much better. Don't you mean there's that other pair? Has this been sabotaged here?
Sugar. Hope I don't do my own. Dane! Do.
I feel a lot of people now realise when
sugar makes it. I slowly look around here and smile right at the lens.
Yeah. I mean, I never tie my own shoelace. I mean, never.
Oh,
I mean, it's just not the thing done in rock and roll. I mean,
he tells all
can you imagine it?
progressed, and we sort of ventured into sort of different areas. When people hear them on the records, we like to do them on stage.
Ow, ow, ow. I'll tell you, I'm editing this lot out.
It's the natural on stage look.
This is called a miracle, folks.
Back in 1977, as a young BBC music presenter, I was asked to make a film about the band as they recorded and toured their sixth album, News of the World.
We love designing these sort of dramatic openings, and particularly the beginning and the end of a show is a great opportunity to do something special. And We Will Rock You, I think in my head, was partly conceived as an opener anyway. I thought, wouldn't that be great just to start off with this very stark stamping and clapping, and it'll be like the audience is starting the show.
We will rock you. We will.
Daddy, you're a ride, make a big nice pain in the street. Gonna be a big man someday. Mud on your face, big disgrace. Kicking your shine all over the place.
We did stay pretty connected. Generally, we sort of found a big place where we'd all get ready together, and we would kind of joke around and talk about stuff. So we had a good kind of camaraderie, which kept us alive.
Arnold!
Yeah.
I think the great thing for us was that we always did sound checks. We did long sound checks every day, and so much happened in the sound checks. We would talk to each other, look at each other, discuss things. We'd figure out what was good about last night, what wasn't good about last night. And, you know, let's try this, dude. Let's see if we can get this song together and try out things and have a bit of fun. It's a kind of dedication, really, but it, boy, it pays off. So I think that saved us from getting fragmented and disconnected. Get your body down, get your big tail down, get your heart beating, baby. Get your timing right, get your act all tight. It's gotta be tonight, my little schoolie. Mama says you don't, daddy says you won't, and I'm boiling up inside. No way I'm gonna lose out this time.
Sammy was low, just watching the show over and over again. One, two, one, two. Sammy was low, just watching the show over and over again. Knew it was time.
America's great. You feel like America is the centre of rock music somehow. There's a real family which surrounds music in America. You go there and you feel that you're part of it. You know?
you've got me in a good mood. Oh, shit, I threw my whistle away, actually. I hesitated, actually, I did. I thought I threw it. I should ask for it back. I want it back.
You threw my best fucking pair of maracas away the first day. Great sound maracas. I mean, it took me hours to steal them.
Now they know I'm going to throw those things. Just goes... Actually, they were wonderful, I must say. I'm sorry. But they, now they know I'm going to throw them in the audience. They give me these horrible things with about 2p's inside, you know, that just rattle, rattle, rattle. And I thought, I feel such a bug going. Nothing happening, so I just throw it away.
Lovely colours as well.
Yeah, lovely colours, lovely kitsch colours. Real height of bad taste.
Really? He's throwing me in the audience.
Don't give him ideas.
You don't rattle as good.
Try your eye. Get your eyepiece.
Oh, horrible use of this bass player. He's going to start taking.
I've got a photograph of him.
Smiling? Oh, how did he get that?
He even managed to get on the video.
Me? I fucking tripped tonight. I was so pissed at myself. I gave hardly got it now I'm here in the darkness. Went arse over tit. Did you see that? That's why I came sort of, I kind of slipped and I went hurtling on and did all this. It really puts you off, doesn't it? It felt real.
I seemed to get together tonight. I mean, I enjoyed
it. Together. Brian broke a string in a, well, the most awkward spot. I mean, like, in the middle of Liar, where it's the crescendo and it comes to a lull. And then he has the cue, so we're all waiting, and he broke the string. So he's changing, we're all I'm standing in the spotlight, aren't we? But anyway, how we've been in worse things. They were good, yeah. It's been different this time, I don't know. Last time the places were smaller, a bit smaller, but they were more up. This time, I suppose, they brought their mums and dads.
Put together, but now to mark the album's full.
What's happening when we go back to London? You're going to be presumably looking at your whole business situation and reviewing it.
Yes, I think we're going to, let's face it, we're going to sort of try and sort out a lot of so-called business problems. And I think, you see, we've always wanted, the Queen, the so-called Queen empires, it's pretty large now. We've all got sort of subsidiary companies and things. And it needs a lot of handling.
You're one of very few bands now that actually haven't left Britain.
We're sort of an English band in a way. We've always lived there. London particularly. We've always recorded in England.
It doesn't change the fact that the taxman still takes a lot of your money. As the albums have progressed, I mean, our sort of songwriting has progressed, and we sort of ventured into sort of different areas. I like writing different songs, you know. We don't like to sort of repeat the same formula.
Are you in the process of restructuring at the moment, business-wise, John?
Potentially, yes. I mean, the first 3 years, we were with a company called Trident, right? It was management record company, the lot, and we were very badly handled. Well, not badly handled. No, we were
badly handled.
We didn't get a penny of record royalties from the first 3 albums from them. It was so basically, we got out of that one, right, by re-signing with a guy called John Reed, who also manages Elm. We signed with him for 3 years, right, which basically comes up, which finishes in about September next year. And what we're looking at that point in time is basically to just look after ourselves and, you know, and do it completely on our own.
It's the long road to artistic and financial freedom, you know, which is so hard to find if you're successful to any degree, because there's a million sharks out there.
Are you happy with the response on the tour so far?
Well, very much so, I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
See, I think it's worth pointing out, really, that it's the most successful tour on the road right now, isn't it?
If you say so, I did. Yeah. Yes.
Well, we wouldn't want to keep abreast of it, but yes.
Yes, yes, it is, really.
There's a lot of competition around. I mean, there is... How many groups on the road? I mean, it's...
Well, I don't know. Of the sort of halls we're playing, no more than half a dozen.
The people here are just geared to going to actually seeing so many rock concerts that, I mean, it's like a way of life, really, isn't it? Mm.
Particularly what strikes me on this tour is how well put together the stage
is, how well designed it is, and how well the stage show works. Can you describe the opening and how you got the idea for it, Freddie?
I don't know. Usually our ideas kind of... how did it start? Somebody comes up with an idea and it's immediately rejected. Mm. But it kind of sort of seeps in after a while, once it's kind of
they
thrown about.
They want to get a row on film, you see.
Yeah, or they want to get a row. You should have been there yesterday. Well, you were there yesterday, but the cameras weren't really...
I hear we split up last week.
Yeah.
According to the NME or
something. Yes, we must develop that. Just to a point. Mm. How did that develop, those rumours?
Oh, it's... Mm. It's not... It's so... It's a lot of trivia. It's not even worth talking about.
Was there any basis in fact for that speculation at all?
Not as far as I know.
Breaking up when we're doing so well? God, yeah. Must be kidding.
I think the most important thing is for a band, basically, it has to be good. And it also has to stick together, I think, and know each other.
Millions, basically, but I'm not sure how many.
Have you got a rough figure?
Not really. We're going to ask Jimmy Carter here,
mate. You said Jimmy.
What did you say, Jimmy?
Well, as you know, I love rock and roll groups. Well, tell me, Bob, what is it like? What is it like being up since 6 o'clock?
It's a ridiculous thing. I'll give it to Bob.
If individually you went off. I'm not talking about the band breakup at all, yeah. But if you made individual solo albums...
Yeah. Oh, I'd make a lot of money.
And I'll ask you individually this. What sort of album would you make, Rog?
Oh, dear. I don't know yet. I haven't done it yet. A good one. I'd like to make it naked and raw.
Fred?
I really haven't thought in those terms, really. I mean, probably my solo album would consist of me singing with Roger Bryan and John backing me.
Most of the things that I want to do, I would want to use the group, because that's partly, we sort of use each other in a way, if we have ideas, and that is the big thing about a group, that you have a group of people who understand each other's ways of working and you can get the maximum out of each other. So there are things which perhaps at the particular time you don't want to do for the group, but mainly that the group is the vehicle, that's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And it's the best vehicle that we have.
John? I'd never do one, no. I can't sing.
You've achieved so much now over the last 5 or 6 years, and I was wondering now what targets you have left to achieve, really.
Number one album in America would be nice.
Yeah, we've never had a number one over here. We've had very successful sort of 2 million selling albums, but we haven't had a number one album. I don't know, and also we could be a bigger draw than we are, you know.
Yes, I mean, we haven't... I don't think the wrong thing to do is to actually sort of see ourselves with a particular goal to meet, you know? I mean, to say, this is where I want to go. It's got to be so wide that, you just keep going. I mean, there's these sort of areas are endless, really.
Mm. You're going to take some time off when you go back to London, aren't you?
That's the plan, yeah. You have to get refreshed every now and again, and we haven't really had a holiday for the last 4 years or so. Mm. We've always said, this is time off, but then it isn't, because you get involved in... projects. So certainly for me, I'm going to get as far away as I can.
True, I think we really deserve it. I think, oh, we bloody well do. I think we've been kind of sort of putting it off for the last 6 years, really. And I think the time has come where we can kind of ease off a bit. And just, on this tour, I've been surviving on just jabs. And I don't mean that in that sense. Oh, please, mother. No. But the show goes on.
Well, with us now in the studios is a man who has a degree in physics and who was a teacher and indeed an astronomer for a few years, all of which was well before he became lead guitarist with one of the world's most successful rock groups, Queen, and I'm talking about Brian May. Brian, you're very welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ken. Hello.
party's over and I'm left cold sober. Baby left me for somebody new. I don't want to talk about it, want to forget about it, want to be intoxicated with that special brew.
Smile.
So come and get me, let me. That says my heart is on an all-time low. So don't expect me to behave perfectly. Now I'm there. Now I'm there. Now I'm there. I'm just.
Just a new.
On December the 28th, we'll be able to see more of the Queen concert, which we broadcast last year as our Christmas special. Brian's with me now. It was the last major concert the band did in London until this event in the glorious summer of 76 from their concert at Hyde Park in London. This is Queen and Sweet Lady.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our picnic by the Serpentine. You all look very beautiful, I must say. We should like to carry on now with a song called Sweet Lady.
Hyde Park this summer. And let me, at this point, welcome to the programme Brian Lee.
Good evening.
Hello, Brian. Welcome.
I'm Bob. Nice to see you again.
Yeah. Let's talk about the film, first of all, because the first thing I'd like to know is what use, eventually, now, you're going to put that film to?
Ah, it's all in the melting pot at the moment. We just pulled that little bit out straight off the tapes to bring along here. I chose it because it was... it's kind of the group in its raw state, which you perhaps don't often see on television. What are we going to do with it? Various ideas. We've used a little bit to make a film for promoting the single, which is, I don't know if you remember the film we did for Bohemian Rhapsody, which was kind of a little art thing in itself. Well, we've done kind of something similar with this. We've had great difficulty with the Top of the Pops people, who have refused to put it on. But we hope sincerely that someone's going to see it sometime. And in that film, we've merged some of the live footage with some studio footage and sort of dissolved from the two. And that's interesting. So that's one use. Maybe one day we'll put a complete film of the show on. But I think it ought to be a documentary to show all the sort of trials and tribulations that went on. I'd love people to know what really happened at Hyde Park.
How massive a project was it, Matt, putting that show together?
It took a lot of people about 8 or 9 weeks solid work, including us. All the traumas from not being able to get permission to do it, you know, to wondering about whether the grass was okay. Remember, there was a drought at that time, and they didn't want us to play if it didn't rain, which is kind of an unusual thing. Nobody realising how long it took to prepare for a thing like that. You can just sort of put it on and off in a day. Lots of things like that. Right up to the last moment, getting very incredibly naturally kind of high before going on, because it was... Although we played to large audiences before, this is London, it's our home, and that's something different. And then afterwards being threatened with arrest if we went on for the encore, which nobody realised at the time, but we were sort of hustled into a van on threat of being taken away to different places. It was very strange, because I think people got nervous of the crowd, and people worried whether it could be controlled in the dark and things like that. But apart from things like that, it was great.
Yeah, you were pleased with it on the day.
I was very pleased,
Just show that, Brian, because
I have to show you this. I've been clutching this in my sweaty paw. This is our tour manager, Jerry Stiggle, scratching his head before the gig beside a model of the tent, sort of wondering whether it would all happen, I think. They did an amazing job, these stages.
Because as far as gigs are concerned, you've been very quiet.
Everybody thinks we've been hibernating. In fact, we've been working very hard on the album, which really takes us a long time, about 4.5 months in all. And
how complicated was it putting the album together this time? Because, I mean, it did take that length of time, and you moved around studios too, didn't
we
you?
We did. We always do, yeah. Partly because I suppose we get a bit bored in one place at one time. Partly because we know studios and know the sounds that they can make. And certain things are better in certain studios.
I noticed one of the things that's happening at the moment, in general terms, is that there's a kind of resistance to the idea of the band spending a lot of money in the studio.
A reaction to the big production?
Yeah.
That's fair enough. I'm all for it. You know, I think there has to be a balance in that way. And I think we even feel it ourselves. You know, some of the tracks on the album are sort of back to basics. In fact, the first track, which opens the album, it's just a pretty basic sort of thing. And we're aware, let's say we're aware of the dangers of getting overproduced. But we like to keep a balance. And I think in some ways we feel that the studio art is an art in itself. This is old stuff, really. I mean, we've always felt that the live stuff was separate, as you know, from the studio. And there are some things which you can do in studios which are perhaps analogous to painting a picture, which you can never do live. And we think those are worthwhile things. And there's some of the most elaborate things we've ever done. You know, there's complete sort of mock orchestras and mock choirs on this album, such as have never been seen before. I'm very excited about it, you know, both sides of it. I enjoy the live work for its own sake very much, and I enjoy trying to get that onto disc, which is a challenge, but also the studio work for its own sake.
Already we're beginning to run out of time, Brian, but let's just talk about next year now, because the first thing that happens is you go to America early on in 1977.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about that. This is hot news. We've just been talking to Thin Lizzy, and we wanted to take them with us, and they are in fact coming. So the tour will be us and Thin Lizzy. Which I think is a great bill. You know, they're going to make us work really hard, which is what we need. So I'm looking forward to putting all that together.
What about Britain, Brian? Any plans later on in the year?
We'll be back in 3 months or so, and we have some tentative plans for playing. I really don't know what's going to happen. I have great hopes for the new tour, because it's a chance to put together a completely different stage act. And I hope we can bring that, you know, it'll evolve in America as it always does, and we'll be able to bring it back to England.
To the very best of luck. Really.
Thank you very much, Bob. Right.
Thanks for coming in tonight.
Cheers. Brian, I'm enjoying heart and...
I've paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence but committed no crime. And bad mistakes I've made a few. I've had my share of bad kids in my bed. And everything that goes with it, I thank you all.
but it's been no bed of roses, no pleasure cruise. I consider it a challenge before the whole human race, and I ain't gonna lose. We are the champions, my friends, and we'll keep on fighting till the end. We are the champions, we are the champions, who can lose us, yes, we are the champions of the world.
As I said, the results for this award ended in a draw. The record that shares the award for the best British single from 1952 to 1977 is Bohemian Rhapsody by Queen. Ladies and gentlemen, Queen. There we are. Thank you. Beautiful number. There we are.
Whilst Bohemian Rhapsody propelled Queen's career into orbit, it also marked the beginning of a new genre that was soon to dominate pop.
Vorrei presentarvi gli altri del gruppo. C'è Freddie Mercury, il cantante. Suona anche il piano in molti pezzi. Qui c'è Brian May, chitarra solista, e John Deacon, il bassista. Vorremmo presentarvi alcune delle diverse esecuzioni registrate durante gli ultimi anni e speriamo che vi piacciono i differenti stili che abbiamo usato nel tempo. Circa due anni fa registrammo un LP intitolato A Night at the Opera. Il titolo del disco ci era stato ispirato da un film dei fratelli Marx. E c'è un 45 giri tratto da questo album che si intitola Bohemian Rhapsody e ha avuto molto successo in tutto il mondo. Vorremmo presentarvelo ora. Siamo qui e adesso parliamo di Now I'm Here. È un film dei Queen dal vivo al Rainbow di Londra, è un grosso teatro della città, mentre eseguiamo un pezzo intitolato Now I'm Here. Era Now I'm Here e ora sono qui. Questo film fu girato molto tempo fa con Queen dal vivo. Il prossimo film evidenzia Brian May, anche questo è un vecchio film, ed è un pezzo intitolato Son and Daughter. C'è Brian May che suona la sua chitarra, di cui molto è stato scritto. Ora vorremmo presentarvi l'esecuzione da cui si sviluppò la nostra presenza scenica negli ultimi anni. Si intitola Son and Daughter e sono i Queen di 4-5 anni fa. Durante l'ultimo tour, i Queen si sono esibiti in vari posti in America e in Giappone, della stessa grandezza, molto simili al vostro Palazzo dello Sport che sta dietro di me. Iniziavamo lo show ogni sera con il pezzo Tie Your Mother Down, che comprende molti effetti scenici, come esplosioni e fumo. Voglio presentarvi il film di come aprivamo gli spettacoli in questo tour. Si intitola Tie Your Mother Down. Ed è più melodico, qualcosa che sicuramente è assai familiare qui in Italia. Il prossimo film, quello che stiamo per vedere, è stato girato in due posti diversi, durante il concerto di Hyde Park, di cui ho parlato, e poi nello studio di registrazione dove i Queen incisero questo pezzo. La nostra idea era quella di mostrare le due diverse facce del gruppo sul palco e nello studio.
Credo che questa canzone sia stato il nostro primo successo in Italia e certamente la riconoscerete. Comunque ve lo ricordo, si tratta di Somebody to Love. Bene, spero vi sia piaciuta questa specie di viaggio attraverso i Queen. Spero vi sia piaciuto ciò che avete visto di noi. Questa è stata la prima opportunità di avere un contatto con l'Italia e con gli italiani. E mi è piaciuto, ma sarebbe meglio e preferibile anche organizzare un'esibizione dal vivo, fare un concerto. Vi gradiremo molto, se possibile, la prossima volta che saremo in Europa, venire in Italia e suonare davanti a voi. Comunque è stato piacevole presentarvi ciò che possiamo fare e vorrei salutarvi con l'ultimo nostro disco intitolato We Are The Champion. Spero che vi sia piaciuto e arrivederci presto, speriamo. Bye bye.
Right, well, Freddie, welcome to Countdown.
Hello.
Welcome to Australia. This is actually the first time we've had a chance, really, to talk to you on Countdown, although you've been very much involved with the show as far as film clips and that is concerned, and with the hit records. If we may, can we go right back to the first tour you ever had of Australia, which was that one concert at Sunbury. At that stage, you were still sort of building up as far as a group was concerned. But I remember at that stage also that the group were utterly convinced that that you were going to be a world-class group. Can we just talk about those times?
How do you mean? I mean, it's just something that we were going through. It's a phase we were going through. I mean, that's the first time we'd sort of been to Australia. Mm. And I mean, I think that they're very good memories. I mean, I can't remember that much about the very first time. I can remember the larger tour that we did. And I think that was a very good reception for us. I mean, numerous little incidents that happened, which were sort of great.
Yes, what I was trying to just go back to, that first time you had already built an amazing visual image on stage, and it was very hard going on at Sunbury, virtually being unknown. As far as the group was concerned, in Australia,
coming in out of this cold to sort of do a headline was kind of difficult. I mean, I know at the time we had a lot of competition from the sort of Australian groups there, and it was a very difficult thing for us to come in from the cold, and it's something that you sort of just learn by experience. I think it was a good thing to do because I mean we had to, rather than sort of do a slow build up, just come in there on the top. And sort of say we're Queen, this is what we're all about.
Right.
And it's nice to sort of go in at the deep end. And from then onwards, I think all it needed was for people to see us
I mean, the most amazing thing was that from an unknown group, and seeing the determination of the group itself, that you were determined in actual fact to break into a world market, that 6 months later, after Sunbury of that year, in Australia, you were in fact becoming one of the world's top groups. Before that? I mean, like prior.
No, I think we've sort of our sort of history, if you sort of go back, has our sort of climb has been very quick, and I think that's, you know, it's just great. Right. I just think we've had the ball sort of started rolling, and then it sort of went so fast during, say, Bohemian Rhapsody time. I think things were moving so fast, we couldn't even keep up.
Right.
I think we've been very lucky, actually. I think we've been sort of, our timing has been right, and we've been in the right place at the right time. And say, for example, in America, I mean, we've only done one support sort of tour in our lives, really. So we have been lucky.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but with the first Queen One album, you spent a lot of time in a recording studio at that stage, because you were in fact backed by a recording company.
Studio. We had a production company named Trident, which we don't have anymore.
Right.
They sort of backed us, yes, and through them we had a recording contract with EMI. Yes,
now, right. obviously, you must have spent more time in the recording studios rather than going out on the road at that stage.
Not true. I think it was half and half, really. Mm. We did the first album very quickly, really. I mean, it took us about 4 weeks, I think. Mm. But it's because we did material that we knew very well. I mean, it was material that we were doing on stage well before, So, I mean, we knew what to do when we went into the studios. Then on, it was all sort of what I call very new material, and a lot of it was written in the studios.
Well, when did the spectacular stage thing, which you had on the first tour in Australia, when did that start to evolve on stage?
I think we had ideas from the very, very early stages. I think it just developed as we got to do more gigs and as we gained experience and things like that. I think there were a lot of ideas that we wanted to try out both on record and on stage. Mm. But it's something that you can't do all at once. I mean, you've just got to be in the right sort of stage in your career to do larger things. Like you couldn't start off with a huge entourage of lights because, I mean, we weren't doing bigger venues. So you had to sort of like wait for your turn. Right. But it came pretty quickly, I think.
Now, with Queen 1, Queen 2, Killer Queen, you were building up an immense album following with those albums. Then, and also, I mean, you're also breaking into the singles market in quite a big way. Mm. But with Bohemian Rhapsody and A Night at the Opera, I mean, that was the absolute breakout.
Yeah, well, that really tore the market up. Tore the market up and down, didn't it? I mean, it sort of, it just kind of got us a totally different, it got us to a very different area. I mean, the cross-section of sort of the public then was so different. I mean, we suddenly realised we were playing to mums and dads, and I mean, like, the people that were coming to see us were totally different. And I think it was a very good thing because, I mean, we just sort of, it was just gathering a much larger sort of audience, really.
Yeah.
And it helped enormously.
Now, for an act that had been so visual on stage, and I'm still referring to the Bohemian Rhapsody time, suddenly, in that year, came one of the classiest film clips that's probably ever been made. And the fact also that it happened to be associated with a group that had probably one of the classiest stage acts.
I think that was a very good period for us, wasn't it?
And so I think, gosh, you know, film.
Yes,
really
I think at that time we were really things were really falling into place, and I think our sort of ideas were really, really gelling and coming to life. And I think that film idea was ours as well. So I mean, I think, in terms of thinking of Bohemian Rhapsody as a record concept, I think we thought of it in terms of visuals as well. And I think I could really picture that sort of song in sort of visuals. So I think when it came to doing the promotional film, I think it was kind of quite easy from quite easy because people think we spent hours and hours making that film. In fact, it took literally about four hours, I think. And
you were breaking a lot of barriers by this stage because, number one, I mean, the album was going bang like that. You were putting on an enormous stage show by this stage. Mm. You had a song with Bohemian Rhapsody that started to break rules because of the fact of the duration and songs, even though back in, say, the late 60s, they were reaching the seven-minute mark. In this period of time, it was unheard of to have a 5-6 minute song sort of thing. And yet, you're absolutely adamant that no one was to cut that down.
I think basically what we do is the way we choose singles are sort of their album tracks, basically. I don't think we actually write a single and say this is going to be the single. And what we, I think, try and do is try and, with each album, try and work out what is where our music is at the current given time, and try and showcase it in say one single, in one sort of number, and that's what takes the sort of single format. With Night at the Opera, we just felt that Bohemian Rhapsody was the song that would sort of say what we're doing at the given time. So we sort of chose that. Obviously, we came across certain barriers, like it being 6 minutes long or whatever, and we said, there were numerous rows. I mean,
well, the recording company wanted to, in actual fact, edit it.
Edit it and things like that, yes. And we just thought, there's no point. You either sort of hear it in its entirety or pick another song.
Yeah.
And I think we were so sort of confident with that sort of number. I mean, it is a risk, I know. And we either thought it was either going to be an enormous flop or a huge success, you know, depending on.
Well, I mean, both the single and the album became, I mean, like, chart monsters, and I noticed that, in fact, Bohemian Rhapsody won an award the other day for one of the best compositions.
BPI thing.
Yeah, for over the past 25 years. The pressure then on the group must have been immense to do the follow-up album, which was A Day at the Races.
True. I think people will, obviously, no matter how hard you try, will think of in terms of your past hits. That's inevitable. But I think it's up to the group and the musicians to really think in other terms. From my point of view, I mean, as far as the writing side of it was concerned, I really thought, I said, okay, Bohemian Rhapsody, big hit. But as far as my writing abilities were concerned, I think I could write better anyway.
Mm.
And I just looked at it from that point of view. I mean, I just went and wrote, from my estimation, I think a song like Somebody to Love is, in my estimation, a better sort of, from the writing aspect, a better song, you see. But I mean, it's very difficult because obviously people think of sort of songs in terms of hits, obviously,
right.
And then they will obviously say, well, Somebody's Love was not as good a song because it wasn't as big a hit. But it really depends on how you look at it. From my point of view, I think my writing ability is getting better.
Well, I remember virtually this time last year, or actually it was a little bit earlier, and I was over here, and you were slightly down, and correct me again if I'm wrong, because you were spending, the whole group was spending so much time, you seemed to be locked away in the studios at that stage.
Oh, God, I know. Those days are gone, thank God.
Yeah.
I think we actually said goodbye to that kind of production after Day at the Races, actually. And on the new one, the News of the World, and we actually decided before we went into the studio that we weren't going to spend so much time. Because I think we've learned enough now to actually try and make quicker decisions.
Yeah.
And we've learned.
Just cut there around Tim, put a new mag. Can you get that a couple of inches of your foot though? Right.
Rolling.
Okay, rolling.
And mark it.
44.1.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong again, but I remember being over here last time, this time last year, just a little bit before, in fact, and you seemed sort of slightly down depressed, the fact that you were spending all your time in the recording studios, locked away, in fact, you said, you know?
Yes, that's true. We're still getting bills from from the Day of the Races. I think we decided on, from the start of this album, even from the onset of actually writing it, writing the material, that we weren't going to spend as much time in the studios. Because I think we've done to death the sort of multi-tracking harmonies and the lavish productions and things. I think we've done it with A Night at the Opera and Day of the Races, certainly. And I just think we felt that we needed a change,
right.
Anyway, from the writing aspect as well. And so I think we wanted a much fresher and a sort of raw approach to songs.
Which brings us to the new album, News of the World. The title itself is sort of almost intriguing. The fact of being sort of a name from a well-known classy paper.
Oh, I didn't know that.
But what's more intriguing of hearing the album, and so the single itself, titled We Are the Champions, the lyrics in We Are the Champions could almost be read in many ways.
Well, you tell me, what do you think?
Well, the first time I heard it and I looked at the lyrics, I wasn't sure because after Bohemian Rhapsody, A Night of the Opera, and then it got to the Day at the Races, which wasn't as big a album as perhaps everyone was expecting it to be. But looking, and there was a fair amount of criticism, I didn't quite know whether We Are the Champions was a sort of a subtle thing of saying, well, you may think, you know.
I think we always write songs like that. It really is up to the listener to make up its interpretation. I think it's nice. I think up to now, I think even now, it's got to a stage where we do it subconsciously, you know, I mean, and we write, especially my songs, I mean, they don't state very categorically. I mean, they're very sort of, they can go into different sort of areas. And I like that, actually. I mean, it's a nice escape for me, from the writer's point of view, but I think from the listener's point of view, it's nice that they can make up different interpretations. So basically, if you ask me what it's all about, I would say it is tongue-in-cheek, and you're it's not to be taken too seriously. I'm like, my God, I can't be serious.
No.
You know, it's something that I wanted to write a song that was very cold and calculated and kind of to the point. And basically, it was a song of sort of participation. I wanted people to sort of participate. I was looking at it from the sort of the show point of view as well, how we were going to sort of do that. And I just thought, why? I wasn't going to sort of beat around the bush. I thought I'm going to be as blatant as possible.
Well, can I just interrupt there? Yeah. I remember also you saying last year that was sort of like being, you might as well be in a jail, the time you were spending in the studios.
Hmm.
And I notice here you've said, I've done my sentence but committed no crime and bad mistakes, I've made a few.
That's all very theatrical.
Right. And then it keeps going, and then it says, which is probably makes a lot of people think, I've taken my bows and my curtain calls. You brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with that. I thank you all. But it's been no bed of roses.
Yeah. It's my way of saying that to a lot of people, I mean, that's like a lot of people think being a rock and roll star is kind of going to a studio, making a disc, and then going around spending all the money, which I don't think it is. And I think, I know that a lot of people do realize that, but even at the same time, a lot of people don't. They think it's a very easygoing life. And I mean, like, a lot of people still think when I say, oh, we're going to America for a tour, they think, oh, nice long holiday. And that's just my way of saying that it's not easygoing. I mean, God, I mean, don't for 1 minute think that it's all peaches and cream.
Well, I find
there's
it
no bed of roses.
I find it intriguing then.
It's hard work. You
know? That suddenly, I mean, like this album, and I don't know what yourself or John or Roger or Brian were anticipating, but suddenly this album's only been out a day or so. It's already broken into the album's chart in England. It's got rave reviews in America so far. Of the people who have heard it. The single is just becoming a giant.
It's working for us. We're very pleased, actually.
Yeah.
It's nice. I think it's a very good step for us because we're moving away from what people thought. I mean, they thought there's going to be another Marx Brothers title.
Yeah.
There's going to be another very overproduced album. And I think they're in for a shock because, I mean, a lot of it sounds very different. And it's very interesting from our point of view because I don't want to sort of churn out the same old formula or the successful formula. I mean, I don't particularly want to sort of write a whole load of rhapsodies, you know? Mm. And it's very interesting for me to write songs like Get Down, Make Love, which is sort of something that we're not used to doing. So it's interesting from our point of view. And if it comes out okay, it's great, you know, something new.
Now, may I ask you a couple of pertinent questions?
Oh, what are they?
The first one being one of the world's top groups, and living in a country, well, I mean, it's true.
You can ask me about taxis, go on.
No, I'm not.
Thank God.
Living in London, with the punk rock craze coming along.
Mm. What's that?
Does it become a challenge, you know, in the sense where you're finding these amazing contrasts, and like you'll find the punk rock writers who will follow a certain stream and may try to put down the established top world acts of today? I mean, is it a challenge to you and the rest of the guys?
It's always been a challenge. It doesn't matter what, even if there is a new movement or call it what you want, there's always a challenge. I mean, take for example the charts today. Mm. I mean, at the moment, I feel this enormous competition with just the established acts.
Mm.
I mean, there's ELO, there's ABBA, there's Rod Stewart. So, I mean, you know, there's always competition, and we're never going to sort of... I'm never one for resting on my laurels, really, because I always know there's that competition, and that's what keeps us, you know, keeps the driving force there.
Well,
but with the new stuff, I know, I think it's all healthy.
Mm.
I think there's always going to be a kind of a new movement, because, I mean, that's how we start.
Can I be bold to say that then I think it almost brings the cunning out in you? I think you almost enjoy it.
Oh, yes. I mean, the day where we sort of say that, well, we're the greatest or whatever. I mean, there you are. We're the champions. I mean, it's not meant to be taken.
But one could almost look at it that way as well.
Yeah. I mean, we certainly haven't hit our peaks. Mm. I mean, there's always, you've got to keep going. I think there's so much we still have to do. Mm. So I think the competition is always there. And whether there be a punk rock movement or call it what you like, it's all there.
Now, may I tick you off just... you and the rest of the group are,
right.
Just in this one sense, where you've done two amazing television specials in the sense that they're in the can, especially the Hyde Park concert, and like I was lucky enough to be in London and see the concert.
Mm.
But really, the rest of the world awaits to see Queen and Hyde Park on video and television. The rumour is that the reason it's being held up is that they're waiting for Queen to go in and edit it.
Who told you that? No, actually, What is being done at the moment is we're doing a sort of, I think, an hour to an hour and a half long documentary. I don't know if I told you that. And that's where a lot, I think that's going to be very good for us, because I think a lot of people have been waiting to actually not just see little spasmodic...
Which we did see as far as the single stuff was concerned.
Yeah, I think people now want to see a more in-depth sort of thing on Queen. And I think a documentary is really inevitable now. And we're sort of working on that right now. So, I mean, I think the release date is set for February in this country.
Right.
And then ultimately it's going to go all over the world. So I think it's going to be much more sort of, much more in keeping of what we're doing, rather than sort of see the odd promo films.
Well, can I congratulate yourself and Brian and John and Roger on a great album.
Well, thanks very much, and, you know.
And a good single. And all I can say is thanks for being on Countdown, and you've got to come down to Australia soon.
Will do.
Thanks very much, Fred.
Thank you.
All right?
Yes.
The band was first brought to my notice in 1971. My brother went and saw them at a nurse's dance in Norwood. And he came back and said they were really amazing. I bought some tapes from Delaney's sessions that had taken place, and we listened to those, his test sessions, and we realised the band had amazing internal drive. Queen caught my imagination, really, by just their own ability, the way they worked together as a four-piece. It was totally interlocked in their thinking, their playing, and that was different to what was going on. I said it would probably be about 5 years, and it was 4 years and 9 months.
Does he regret having lost the band?
Oh, yes, I'd be stupid to say not.